Everyone in the back, could please take your seats. We're about to get started with our next speakers. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Robert George and Dr. Ryan T. Anderson. This afternoon, they will discuss a variety of topics, including free speech, identity politics, and the philosophical roots of current morally charged political debates. Dr. Ryan T. Anderson is the president of the Ethics and Public Policy Center and the founding editor of Public Discourse, the online journal of the Witherspoon Institute. He is the author and or co-author of 5 books, including the recent released Tearing Us Apart, How Abortion Harms Everything and Solves Nothing. And his previous titles include When Harry Became Sally, Responding to the Transgender Movement, and Truth Overruled, The Future of Marriage and Religious Freedom. He has made appearances on ABC, CNN, CNBC, MSNBC, and Fox News. His written work has been published by the New York Times, the Washington Post, and the Wall Street Journal. Dr. Robert George holds Princeton University's celebrated McCormick Chair in Jurisprudence and is the founding director of the James Madison Program in American Ideals and Institutions. Dr. George is the author of multiple titles, including In Defense of Natural Law, Making Men Moral, Civil Liberties and Public Morality, and The Clash of Orthodoxies, Law, Religion, and Morality in Crisis. His scholarly articles and reviews have appeared in such journals as the Harvard Law Review, the Yale Law Journal, and the American Journal of Jurisprudence. Professor George is a recipient of many honors and rewards, including the Presidential Citizens Medal, the Honorific Medal for the Defense of Human Rights of the Republic of Poland, and the Canterbury Medal of the Bucket Fund for Religious Liberty. In addition to the many aforementioned titles, Drs. George and Anderson co-authored the book, What is Marriage? Man and Woman, a Defense. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming them to the stage.
Great. Well, thank you for that kind introduction, and it's a pleasure to be with all of you today. My role is really just to ask Professor George difficult questions. And so I'm going to be posing a bunch of difficult questions to him, and then we're going to save 20 minutes at the end to get your questions. So you're going to have a chance to ask him some difficult questions. And I think we're going to start, as the introductions, the bios are being read, they mentioned that, you know, the very first thing that we collaborated on in a scholarly way was a journal article for the Harvard Journal of Law and Public Policy titled, What is Marriage? And then 2 years later, we turned it into a book and we gave it a more descriptive subtitle, Man and Woman, a Defense. Last week, we saw 47 Republicans in the House of Representatives cross the aisle to vote with all of the Democrats to redefine marriage as a matter of federal law, enshrining the bad decision of Obergefell into federal statute. And it goes beyond that as well. We could talk about the problems of that bill at length, but as a starting point, first difficult question, what is marriage?
You're a married man, right?
As far as I know.
Yeah. And you need me to tell you what marriage is? First, I want to say what a pleasure it is to be back at the Young Americas Foundation. I've had the opportunity of speaking here on a number of occasions. It's always something that I look forward to. And what a joy and a blessing to be with my dear friend, Ryan Anderson, who was once my research assistant, and now he's the president of a big, important conservative think tank in Washington, D.C., and I'm so immensely proud of him. So Ryan has put the question to me and to us, what is marriage? Well, marriage is the relationship that brings together a man and a woman in a permanent and exclusive bond as husband and wife to be father and mother to any children born of that union, conferring on any children born to them the inestimable blessing of being brought up in the care of their biological progenitors, if all goes well. We have adoption in case things don't go as we hope, but in the normal case, when things go well, their biological progenitors, and conferring on those children the benefit of both maternal and paternal care, influence, and role models. That's what marriage is, and that also helps to explain why marriage is of concern to a society and indeed to a polity. Ask yourself the question. We're not concerned as a society or a polity with baptisms or bar mitzvahs or other purely private religious ceremonies or events. But every society known to human history has been concerned with marriage. There have been somewhat different understandings of marriage, sometimes quite dramatic ones, like the difference between monogamous and polygamous understandings of marriage. But all societies have seen marriage not simply as a private matter, but as a public one. And of course, the explanation for that has to do with children. If you get men and women together for any length of time at all, pretty soon there are going to be kids. And those kids need the care and concern of their parents. They need the influences of their mothers and their fathers in order to grow up to be decent, honorable people, citizens who know how to fulfill their responsibilities. Now, miracles happen. Sometimes children, even born in the most tragic of circumstances, can nevertheless come out fine. And God bless them. And God bless anybody who helps in those situations. But the most reliable way to make sure that, on the whole, kids come out okay is to ensure a healthy institution of marriage in the society.
So what you heard there was, you know, Robbie said that marriage unites a man and a woman as husband and wife to then be prepared to assume the responsibilities to be a mother and a father. The state has an interest in this, not because it cares about the butterflies that you get in your stomach when you fall in love, you know, as if it's a sucker for romance. The state cares about this that, you know, it needs something that only families can produce, the next generation of citizens, but something that the state itself can't produce. Right? It needs a civil society institution. It needs the marital-based family to both bear and then rear that next generation of young people. But at the very beginning of Robbie's answer was that marriage unites a man and a woman. And so that leads to the next difficult question. I recently watched a very thorough documentary, went global, asking experts all around the globe the difficult question, what is a woman?
An adult female human being.
Can you say more?
Sure.
I mean, that is the correct answer, but.
Yeah. Yeah. We are male or female depending on our biological makeup. We are not male or female depending on our psyches. What makes me a male is not my mind. It is most fundamentally my body. My body is organized toward the male reproductive function. Same for a woman. A woman's body is organized toward the female reproductive function, organized fundamentally to produce the large gamete, the ovum, in the same way that the male is organized to produce the male gamete, the sperm. Now, it's of course possible that there are abnormalities. There are abnormal cases. Ryan has written very illuminatingly about this in his book, When Harry Became Sally. But those cases do not establish any third sex. There is no competent biologist who believes that there is a third sex. There's no third sex just as there's no third gamete. In fact, there's no third sex because there is no third gamete. What you do have sometimes are abnormalities or malfunctions, often genetic, that will cause some, for example, female tissue to be present in a male human being. That is a human being who is organized toward the male role in reproduction. But that does not make that male human being into a female or certainly into a third sex. One fundamental error in thinking these days, which Ryan, perhaps we should get into in a little more detail further in our conversation, is the supposition that what a person is, male or female person, that what a person is the psychic part of the self, the conscious and desiring part of the self, the mental part of the self, and that the body is not part of the personal reality of the human being, but rather is an impersonal or subpersonal instrument of the real person, who's not the body, but is rather the mind or soul, or if you want to put a religious connotation on it, the spirit. But that's actually not what persons are. Persons are not ghosts living in machines. Persons are dynamic unities of body and mind, or body and soul, or body and spirit. The sound understanding of the human person understands that we are wholes. We're not separated, two separated things. The view that so much that's erroneous in contemporary thought, especially in contemporary ethics, the ideas that are responsible for so much of the bad thinking in this area are ideas that presuppose that there are really two separate things. The mind or psyche, which is the real person, and then the body, which is just the subpersonal instrument used by the real person. And on that misunderstanding of humanity, people can suppose, for example, that there is a mismatch. A female person, that is a psychic female, living in a male machine. And then, of course, the question is, okay, how do we straighten this out? Well, we try to alter the machine to make it match the person. But we're not ghosts in machines. We are integrated wholes. We're unities of body and mind, or body and soul, or body and spirit. We are male or female the whole way through. We're established as male or female from the very beginning. We remain male or female throughout our entire lives.
And that leads directly to the next question. But before posing it, I just want to quickly give you a recap of that. What Robbie stressed, what is a woman? He says adult human female. Well, what is a female? This is true across all the mammalian species, right? It's how a mammal is organized with respect to sexual reproduction. There are two ways of being organized. Right. Robbie said, you know, there's the way of being organized that would create the large gamete, the way that would create the smaller gamete. Another way of putting it is, you know, those who donate the genetic material, those who receive the genetic material, those who reproduce outside of their body, those who reproduce inside of their body. And this is true not just for humans, right? Farmers, ranchers, a variety of ordinary Americans need to be able to readily identify the male and the female of the species as part of their basic livelihood. And all of our parents, grandparents, great-grandparents have been doing this for generations, right? If they grew up on a farm, if they were engaged in any sort of animal husbandry, et cetera, and it's only now, in like late modernity, when we are, you know, uber-educated to be smarter than anybody else in all of, that we have basic questions about what is a female, what is a male, what is a woman, what is a man. And as Robbie pointed out towards the end, it's largely based upon a bad ideology. I'm going to come back to that in a minute, but I want to ask one more difficult question, and then we're going to see how these first three all hang together. Professor George said a woman is an adult human female, and so my next question is, but when do women begin? And, you know, obviously they're adults, so when does that adult come into existence? So prior to becoming an adult, that female, that human female, when did she come into existence?
All right, so if you or I is not a psyche residing in a material body, but is a unity, as I've argued, then the question is, when did that unity come into existence? When was there a body that is continuous with the body that is now me? All right, well, we know that the person who is now the 37-year-old Ryan Anderson.
That's very generous.
Is the very same person, the very same human being, the very same biological organism, the very same integrated whole that was a few years ago when I met him, the Princeton University undergraduate, maybe 19 or 20 years old. And before that, the outstanding high school student. And a few years before that, the precocious 9-year-old. And 7 years before that, the 2-year-old toddler running around getting into trouble. And just about 2 years before that, the newborn infant. And just before that, the 7-month fetus. And just before that, the 3-week embryo. And just before that, the newly conceived zygote. Ryan, like you or me or any other member of the human family, began when a new and distinct organism came into existence, ordinarily by virtue of the union of sperm and egg. If you want me to explain that ordinarily, I will. By the union of sperm and egg, giving rise to a new entity, beginning in the embryonic stage, that is both genetically and functionally distinct from his or her parents. That is, he or she is not a part, not a body part, of the male or female progenitor, the mother or the father, but is genuinely a distinct creature whose biography now begins. Things start happening to him that will matter for the rest of his or her life. And I keep saying his or her because sex in the human, this isn't true in all species, but sex in the human is established from the very beginning. We come into being as male or female, and of course we continue as male and female through the rest of our lives. So we can say of each of us that I was an embryo just as I was a fetus, a newborn infant, a child, an adolescent, and now an adult. I, or you, or anyone else, developed from the embryonic into and through the fetal, infant, child, and adolescent stages and into adulthood with my or your determinateness, unity, and identity fully intact. Here's something no one can deny, that you or I or any other member of the species was once an embryo. You were not once an egg cell. You were not once a sperm cell. Those were parts of other human beings, genetically and functionally. But when you were conceived not as a part of another human being, but as genetically and functionally distinct from your parents. So when does a woman begin? When does a man begin? When does a person begin? At the very beginning, from the formation of the zygote through sexual union. I'll just very quickly explain that ordinarily. That little caveat I threw in there. And if you read the major texts in human embryology and developmental biology, you'll see this reference. By the way, I would urge you and everyone else to read those texts. And if you're pro-life as I am, I think you should make those texts required reading for your pro-choice interlocutors, because they all tell exactly the same story, the story I just told. And when you have them read those texts, I think you should remind them of the importance of not being a science denier. Don't want to be a science denier now. Okay? So that ordinarily is the rare case of monozygotic or identical twinning. So in that case, you begin with a single embryo, and then by either a division of the embryo or a budding from the embryo, you end up with two genetically identical, although even there's some caveats, I won't go into them here, genetically identical human beings. So in that case, you would say at least of the second that his or her origins are in that event of the splitting or the budding. But in the normal case, it's on conception.
So for everyone in this room, unless you are an identical twin, unless you're a monozygotic twin, you came into existence at conception. That, and for 99% of all humans, that's going to be the case. So in this auditorium, there are probably a handful of you who are identical twins. Everyone else came into existence at conception within the first 14 days prior to the formation of the primitive streak. That early embryo can give rise to twins.
And so, if it's true that each and every member of the human family, just in virtue of his or her humanity, has rights, including the right to life. Now, this is something that my liberal friends and progressive friends tell me they believe in, that each and every member of the human family has basic dignity and basic rights simply in virtue of his humanity. If that's the case, then every single human being, including that identical or those identical twins, had that dignity and that right to life from the very point at which he or she came into existence.
So for those three difficult questions, things that, you know, every one of our grandparents, you know, took for granted and didn't need no fancy Ivy League professor explaining to them the correct answer to, there's an underlying ideology that actually connects all three of them. The redefinition of marriage, the redefinition of male and female, the science denial on the unborn child in the womb, and the dignity and worth and equality of the unborn child in the womb. And you've referred to it as Gnostic liberalism. The Gnostic part capturing the body-self dualism, and then the liberalism part, to a certain extent, capturing what Robert Bella had referred to as expressive individualism. What Carl Truman, I see many of you are carrying around Carl Truman's excellent book.
It's just,
and where Truman points out that it's that combination of dualism and expressive individualism that explains so much of what's going on. Can you explain, it's the first things at the essay by you with the title Gnostic Liberalism, where you connect how these three issues hang and fall together based upon that bad underlying anthropology?
So the Gnostics, G-N-O-S-T-I-C-S, the Gnostics were people in the early years of Christianity in Christian and Jewish communities who would emerge as the losers in a great theological context. To both Orthodox Judaism and Orthodox Christianity. But the Gnostics had among their many beliefs, one belief that all had in common was this belief in person-body dualism, that the person is not his or her body, but merely resides in his or her body, the ghost in the machine view, which is then, you know, rejected by both mainstream of Judaism and, of course, Christianity. Although it's not just the Jews and the Christians that reject it, while it was, a variant of it was embraced by Plato, his great student Aristotle rejected it in favor of a view labeled hylomorphism, which we get the label from Aristotle, this idea that we're not ghosts and machines, that we are in fact unities. But what's relevant to contemporary ethical debates is this. You can see how the idea that we are fundamentally, as persons, minds or psyches, and not bodies, informs the progressive view on so many issues. So, for example, if what a person is a psychic center, or a center of feeling, or rationality, and not the body, then we can avoid being science deniers. We could admit that from the earliest embryonic stages, you have a human being. But you can deny that all human beings are persons, and you can claim that human beings prior to the emergence of a sufficient, readily available mental functioning, degree of mental functioning, prior to that, you don't have a person. You have a human being who's not a person. This is the view famously articulated and defended by my Princeton colleague, Peter Singer. So that will enable you, without science denial, to affirm abortion. But of course, if you do that, then you have to go the whole way with Professor Singer and others who adopt this view and say that since even newborn children don't yet function rationally, that infanticide as well as abortion is morally permissible. And Singer and others of his school bite the bullet and affirm the moral permissibility of infanticide. You can see how it underwrites the progressive view on euthanasia. That, Uncle Henry might have once been a person when he was rational, but now he's suffering from a dementia or other cognitive disability, and therefore he is no longer a person. Sure, he's a human being, a member of the human species, he's living, but he's not a person, and therefore it's okay to kill him. Same with severely cognitively disabled people. Same thing when it comes to transgenderism. If fundamentally as people, as a person, as persons, we are psyches and not bodies, if what matters is the psyche and not the physical reality of the human being, then you could have a person who is biologically male, but that's not who he is because he's not his biology, he's not his body. He is the psyche. And so he can look into himself, into his psyche, and what does he discover there? A gender identity. And this gender identity in his case happens to be female. So he's actually not male, he is female. Same with the institution of marriage and with sexual morality generally. This person-body dualism, understanding the person as the psychic center, underwrites the whole liberal agenda when it comes to marriage and sexuality, because if we are fundamentally minds inhabiting bodies or psyches inhabiting bodies, then what marriage is, as an institution or a bond that unites two people in a fundamental way, is a union of psyches. It's an emotional union. And of course, two people of the same sex, or three or four or five people of whatever combination of sexes, can unite emotionally. But if you take the hylomorphic view, if you reject that Gnostic person-body dualism and see the body, and not just the psyche, the body is fundamental to who we are because we're unities of body and mind or body and spirit, then what marriage is what historically our culture and so many other cultures have held it to be, a union of two persons in every dimension of their being founded upon, whose matrix, whose foundation is the biological unity made possible by sexual reproductive functioning, by sexual reproduction. So that accounts for something that's inexplicable on progressive or liberal terms, and that is the historic requirement, not just in the law of the church, but in the law of the state, that marriages be consummated, and that they be consummated by acts that fulfill the behavioral conditions of procreation, whether or not the non-behavioral conditions happen to obtain. It also explains why all societies that have endorsed, which most have, something like the conjugal understanding of marriage, have understood that while children are a natural fulfillment of marriage, marriage is not simply a means to which children are the ends, but marriage is intrinsically valuable as a relationship ordered toward the having of children, such that even couples who are beyond childbearing age or for whatever reason cannot have children can still be married so long as they can consummate the relationship. So infertility is not an impediment to marriage. The historic view embraced by most cultures makes sense if you understand the background understanding of what a person is. It doesn't make sense if you simply assume Gnostic dualism, which our progressive friends do.
So we're getting to the point where you're going to be able to ask questions of Professor George. So I just want to ask lightning round now. We have 30 seconds before we need to get to student questions. I mean, you made a career at Princeton. You got tenure at Princeton by defending these truths, and not just defending these truths as truths of philosophy, but as truths for law and politics. So as an untenured professor going up for tenure, you were defending the right to life of the unborn and the jurisdiction of the state in protecting unborn human life. You were defending the concept of marriage as the union of man and woman and the role of the state in defining marriage correctly. I don't even think transgenderism was a debate back when you were going up for tenure, so I don't believe you were writing on that back then. But so two questions. Why is it that today, many of the students in the audience, if they were to say the same exact things that you've been saying for 40 years now in your professional career, they would be canceled. They would be shouted down. Their academic freedom, their free speech would not be respected. And then two, why is it that so many, particularly conservatives, seem to think it's not the jurisdiction of the government or the state to define marriage correctly, to protect unborn human life, to define sex rather than gender identity? Many who seem to think the law can be neutral on these questions.
Well, to the latter question or latter part of the question, I think unfortunately a lot of conservatives have bought into the premises of progressive ideology. They still want to resist some of the conclusions, but they've bought into the premises. Most probably haven't thought, for example, of the anthropological presuppositions of the progressive views that they are willing to endorse, say when it comes to abortion or marriage. And here I think we just need to urge people, we need to educate people to think about that. Remember, this is good advice just generally, beyond any question that we're talking about up here today. Just generally remember this. If someone asks you to accept a proposition, be really careful, because in accepting any proposition, in endorsing any proposition, you are endorsing everything it logically presupposes and everything that it entails. So you ought to pause and think carefully about what it presupposes and what it entails. And most people don't do that, and alas, most conservatives don't do that, and they end up backing themselves into some bad places as a result of that, including sometimes backing themselves into their adversaries' presuppositions about things. And I think that's what's going on a lot of the time when it comes to the issues that you're talking about. Look, even back in the Middle Ages when I was coming up for tenure,
those were the good old days.
Yeah, you have to take it on faith. It wasn't exactly easy to be saying things that flew in the face of the progressive orthodoxy. We didn't have the word canceling yet, at least for these purposes. But we did have terms like political correctness. And I did see friends and colleagues, conservative academics, who were denied tenure or lost other educational or professional opportunities as a result of standing up for the sanctity of human life and all stages and conditions, or the dignity of marriage as the conjugal union of husband and wife, or the elementary defense of religious freedom and the rights of conscience. But I think the key thing is to understand not only what you believe, but why you believe it. You gotta think, why do I believe this? And then the second, and perhaps even more important thing, more salient for these purposes, is you have to understand your adversary's position better than he does. The most powerful defense, thesis defense, dissertation defense I ever saw was by our friend, my academic colleague now, for my former student, Daniel Mark, I think who's spoken here, of Villanova University. And what was amazing about that defense is he was up against liberal questioners, progressive questioners, and he's a conservative Orthodox Jewish student and defending conservative positions. And they would fire what they thought was a very tough question at him. And what he would do is sharpen the question. Yep. Because he understood their argument better than they did, he could actually improve their question and then answer it, knocking down their
demolishing argument.
Demolishing it. That's what we've got to do. I can tell you this for sure. Because the elite culture is essentially an echo chamber, your progressive friends, those with whom you are in debate on these issues, will not know the philosophical argument for any conservative view. They just will not know it. It'll be a very rare progressive student or professor who knows why the conservative believes what he or she believes. That puts you at an enormous advantage rhetorically in argument, because they just have no idea. But you've got to be in a position where you not only know why they believe what they believe, you understand their argument better than they do. You can reproduce it, and then you can say what's wrong with it. Yeah.
That is perfect advice, and it's why so many of Robbie's students have gone on to great success in a variety of domains: journalism, academia, public policy, the law. There are members of Congress and the Senate who are your former students, editors of major national conservative magazines, professors, at Notre Dame Law School, Sharif Girgis, Villanova, Danielle Mark, Wheaton College. I mean, we could go through the list. So
people who argue the Dobbs case in front of the Supreme
Court. Scott Stewart, the guy who won the case for us was a Robbie student. All right, let's go to your questions. We have two microphones line up. We're gonna start right here on the left. So
I'd love to hear where you're from as well as your name.
Yep, so you're up.
Hi, I'm Victoria Kirby. I'm from North Carolina University in South Carolina. And our chapter has a question for you. So we are a part of the Young Americans for Freedom chapter, and today's culture really poisons the word freedom instead of liberty. And we were wondering how, by enforcing this ideology, how do we respond? The argument, do we use the word liberty versus freedom?
Well, I myself have just used the word synonymously in my own work. I haven't tried to draw a distinction between the two. I think the distinction that's relevant is the distinction between liberty and license. This is a distinction very important to the American founders. Some of you no doubt have read the Federalist Papers. Yeah, everybody should. That should be required reading. There should be no conservative in the United States who has not read the Federalist Papers, at least the most important ones. Try to read them all, but read Federalist 10, Federalist 1, Federalist 51, Federalist 78. And it was very important for them to distinguish honorable liberties: freedom of speech, freedom of the press, freedom of religion, freedom of assembly, the right to petition the government for redress of grievances and so forth, from dishonorable so-called liberties, which our founders would call license. They understood that for people to succeed in self-government, for republican government, government not only of and for the people, but by the people to prevail, you needed people who could govern themselves. That is, keep their own wayward passions and desires in check and act on the basis of what is reasonable and right, what is good and just and true, not on the basis of the wayward passions. To act on the basis of the wayward passions is license. You can dress it up as liberty, but it's actually just license. What we conservatives, I think any honorable people, what we should be concerned with is protecting liberty, or if you prefer, freedom, and distinguishing it from license. Just doing whatever you please, for whatever reason, just because you please. Honorable liberties are liberties that protect important human goods. The right to freedom of speech protects the good of truth. The right to freedom of religion protects the good of getting ourselves into right relationship with God. There are reasons for those freedoms. It's just not a matter of doing what you please because that's what you please.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Allison and I'm from the University of Michigan. A lot of the early transgender movement focused on the societal stereotypes around sex, not purely the biological and physiological differences. Do you think there are any value to those societal stereotypes, or do you think that the real focus of gender and sex, obviously used interchangeably here, should be on the biological aspect?
Ryan, you've worked on this. What do you say?
Sure. I think the critique has value to a certain extent. There can be overly stereotypical understandings of what a real boy is and what a real girl is, where you say, you know, boys play with G.I. Joe, girls play with Barbie. And so the early critique was, wait, it's perfectly fine if a boy wants to play with Barbie, it's perfectly fine if a girl wants to play with G.I. Joe. And so there's actually something about kind of second wave feminist critiques of sex stereotypes that then transgender ideologues double down on. Because now all of a sudden they're saying that if the boy plays with Barbie, that's actually a sign that she's a girl, right? I mean, that's what they would even change the pronoun already. And if the boys, I guess I gave that, so if the girl is now playing with G.I. Joe, that's a sign that he's actually a boy, right? So in a certain way, transgender ideologues are actually doubling down on the very stereotypes that the second wave feminists were trying to combat. A healthy understanding of sex and of gender would see that there are sexual differences, bodily differences, that make a difference with respect to the human goods that they outfit us for, that they equip us for. And so the cultural trajectory should be that the boy grows up to be a man, to assume a vocation of being a husband and a father. The girl grows up to be a woman, to assume the vocation of being a wife and a mother. And then there are going to be various cultural norms that we try to cultivate. You can think of like agriculture and horticulture, cultivating the earth, cultivating agriculture. Right? Human culture cultivates human nature, right? And so we actually need certain scripts, social scripts, cultural scripts, to help that trajectory take place. Physically, yes, unless you use puberty blockers, the boy will become a man, the girl will become a woman. That's going to be biological. Whether or not they're then prepared for a vocation of husband and wife, of mother and father, a variety of cultural and social traditions, practices need to be in place. And you can go wrong in one direction by denying that there are differences that make a difference between male and female, boy and girl. You can also distort those differences. Men are from Mars, women are from Venus. Aristotle teaches that virtue is the mean between two extremes. And so that one extreme of denying the differences, the other extreme of distorting the differences, what we want to do is highlight and channel the differences that make a difference with respect to human goods, human flourishing. This is going to be marriage and the family as the focal case. But none of that suggests who should be the doctor, who should be the nurse, who should be the lawyer, who should be the paralegal, right? I mean, there have been times in human history where we had bad stereotypes and saying that, well, because you're a woman, you can't be educated, you can't become a doctor, can't become a lawyer. We now have the opposite error of saying, well, there are no differences that make a difference. And, you know, gender is now a spectrum and the sexes are interchangeable, mothers and fathers, are interchangeable, et cetera, et cetera. So the challenge, and this is always the challenge, every virtue, there are two opposing vices. And so we have to be able to titrate this accurately, rejecting both of the false alternatives and really focusing on the truthful path forward.
Lots of tomboys have grown up to be wonderful wives and mothers, and often still tomboys. Lots of sensitive boys, sometimes called effeminate boys, have grown up to be wonderful fathers and husbands, and often still pretty sensitive. Most cultures can understand that and work with that. Ours, for a very, very long time, were able to do that. I mean, we didn't bring down the hammer on girls who like to play with trucks or climb trees who were tomboys. I think what's happened is the larger ideological frame has become distorting. We've really moved fully into what I sometimes call the age of feeling. This is really what Carl Truman's book, his wonderful book, is about. Historians are fond of breaking up, especially intellectual historians, are fond of breaking up the epochs into the age of this and the age of that. So they refer to the medieval period as the age of faith. And, you know, while that's a bit of an exaggeration or it's oversimplification, it's certainly true. You know, faith was the sort of touchstone of truth and goodness and rightness. It wasn't as if there was no attention paid to reason. Think of the great philosophers, Islamic, Jewish, and Christian of the medieval period. But still, there's a certain truth in the idea that the Middle Ages were the age of faith. And the Enlightenment period is sometimes called the age of reason. And there's some truth in that as well, although it was also true that lots of important Enlightenment thinkers were people of faith. But if the medieval period was the age of faith and the Enlightenment was the age of reason, what's our age? What age do we live in? Well, I'm afraid to say we live in the age of feeling, where feeling becomes the touchstone of truth and goodness and rightness and justice and so forth. And both reason and faith are eclipsed or put into the shade, and we fall into the kinds of errors of subjectivism that are really explained so well in the book, in Carl Truman's book. So I think we have to stand for faith and reason in the face of the pressures of the age of feeling.
Robbie's history books are much kinder to the Middle Ages. Mine said it was the age of superstition. I mean, you're say it's the age of faith. Yep, over here.
I'm Nathan, I'm from William and Mary. I have a question about your philosophy of the unity, defining the body's unity, and how it relates to death and religious philosophy, which might be more dualistic in the sense that, you know, you have matters of the flesh and matters of the spirit. When you die, your soul or your spirit goes to heaven. Do you think there's a contradiction between those two understandings of what human is?
I do not, and it's a very good question. I do not think there's a contradiction, and I think you'll see that there's not a contradiction if you consider why both Judaism as it developed and Christianity came down in the end for the doctrine of the resurrection of the body. After all, take the Christian case. It would have been so much easier a sale in the Roman world, in the Roman Empire, to say, well, Jesus rose in the sense that his spirit is still with us. Of course, not his body. His body's rotting away in the grave, but his spirit is still with us. He's spiritually among us. He exists spiritually, and when we die, it's not that we're going to rise from the dead. Our souls will go to heaven, and we'll live in the true us in the spiritual state. That would have been so much an easier sale. They would have gotten in so much less trouble had they done that. They didn't. Why? Because why did they fight the Gnostics so hard? Ultimately prevailing. It's because they understood that a human being, a human person, is not just a ghost in a machine, that the body is not a subpersonal instrument of the human being, but is part of the personal reality of the human being, and that Jewish and Christian ethics, any sound ethics, cannot actually be rationally defensible apart from an understanding of the body as part of the personal reality of the human being. So they went for the mat, they went to the mat for the doctrine of the resurrection of the body, and of course it remains in both Jewish and Christian thought, a central tenet of the faith. So even when you die, only the spiritual remains exist until, according to Jewish and Christian doctrine, the resurrection, when the whole person is in his perfected state exists. And we exist in eternity, in beatitude, as embodied. We don't leave our bodies behind as unnecessary because the real us is the psyche. Does that help?
Yeah, thank you.
There's a great quote from Thomas Aquinas that I first encountered when I was your research assistant, where Aquinas says that when I die, my soul goes to heaven, but I'm not there because I'm not my soul, and it's not until the resurrection of the body that I go to heaven. You probably have it memorized at this point, but do we have time for one?
Well, I should just say, just to make sure we haven't misled anybody on Christian doctrine here, there are two, that's one view of Christian doctrine. It was the view held by Aquinas. The alternative view is that, well, when I die, but before the resurrection, my soul continues to exist, but it is a desiccated or a mutilated part of me. Mm-hmm. So when you die, you have spiritual remains and physical remains. The spiritual remains are, in some sense, still living, of course. The bodily remains are not, but it is with the resurrection that the person exists in what I said a moment ago, the perfected state. But you can see how serious Christianity is about the anti-dualist position, about the resurrection of the body, from just how far Aquinas was willing to take it in the quotation that Ryan just reminded us of, that when I die, but before the resurrection, my soul is in heaven, but I'm not there.
It looks like you're our last question.
Good time, one more.
Hello to you both. My name is Nathan. I go to University of California, Santa Barbara. Oh. And my question is, I read your amicus brief on the Dobbs decision. It was one of the best amicus brief ever read. My question is, would you be willing to, I suppose, commit to a similar amicus brief to the upcoming Supreme Court case, SFFA versus Harvard, which challenges affirmative action, and basically the challenge, the usage of race in college admission and supposed in academia?
Yeah, I'm very interested in that case. This is an area of equal protection jurisprudence that I've taught in and written a little bit in. If you look in my book, Conscience and Its Enemies, you'll see a chapter on there precisely on this topic. It's not on the case, which hadn't been filed when I wrote that chapter, but it's on the very topic of the case. I haven't been invited to write an amicus brief on that one, but if I am invited, I'd be very much open to it.
Thank you.